and then our final panelist, I promise you, Geeta, this will be the first politician you will like, is Mbali Ntuli, who is a Democratic Alliance politician. We didn't invite her as a politician, but as a South African who's young, she's still in her 20s, very thoughtful and engaging about the country, and one of those South Africans who decided to get involved in politics. She's had a bit of a national profile, leader of the DA youth for a while, but she also has been at the coalface of governance in local municipalities in KZN. She certainly seems to be enjoying her time. Some thought that she was sent to political Siberia for fighting with some of her political elders. But I think that the experience that she has gained already sets her apart from many of us young people and us older folks who are commentarian but don't necessarily get involved in governance structures inside the state, let alone at local government level. Can we please welcome Mbali Ntuli to this conversation?
Good evening, everyone. I think the first thing to say is that I'm fully aware of my age and my lack of experience with the panelists that we have here today. So mine is to, at least I think, give a perspective in a political sense, but not in terms of any sort of political stance or party, and that's just because that's where my greatest time is spent. But I think it's also what we need to start really rethinking in South Africa, because we can have all of these conversations and we can have these dialogues and we can talk about it and we can analyze, you know, what the problems are, and I mean, I think Geeta spells out quite a lot of the realities that we know. But if we are to reach this ideal that we are talking about in South Africa, and one that was, you know, pursued from 94 onwards, I think we need to relook at the way that our political systems are structured. Because I think that one of the things in South Africa that is incredibly depressing, and one of the things that makes it so difficult for an ordinary citizen to be able to have any real stake in what is happening in this country, is that actually our public representatives don't actually represent many of the people here. And even if they don't, there's nothing that you can do to hold them accountable outside of the votes. And I don't think that's good enough. And I don't think that actually does anything, because we all know how party political lists work. And frankly, and I can even speak from my party's perspective, there is to some degree an element of having to toe a party line. And I think that that's one of the things that's destroying both the ANC and the DA and all political movements in South Africa, because once you disallow specific people and organizations to have the space to conceptualize and put across different ways of how we need to be solving these problems, you actually are hindering them, and you are actually making them just sit there and be backbenchers and kind of just fill up the space and maybe do one or two good things in terms of service delivery for the community. But we're never going to get to a state where we can actually fully realize the freedoms that we fought for and the freedoms that we wanted to pursue after 94 if we don't change our political system. And I say this very honestly, because I myself am a politician and I'm often frustrated with the way in which my party does things, and I often think that there's alternatives and I often want to voice those things, and you can behind closed doors, but that means nothing, because the public doesn't get to hear that, and the public doesn't actually get to be involved in those conversations and to really say which politician or which representative they feel best actually can articulate what needs to be done. And so I do think, and I'll get to a little bit later, that we really need to relook the system of how our politics is working in this country, because I think we can all agree that that's where the most power lies and that's where the most action can be taken to address some of these concerns that we have. But if we're not going to relook the system, then we're not going to actually change anything, and we'll continue to have these conversations and we'll continue to bemoan the state of our economy and the state of our social ills, but without any real change. And I want to say, you know, I was in grade one in 1994, and I remember quite clearly the euphoria that Geeta was talking about, and I think it was a big thing that propelled me into trying to understand politics, even outside of what my familial interest in it would have been. And it's always stayed with me how incredibly excited people were for what they thought Africa was going to bring. And I think if you look around the world now, we still see so many conflicts of different states or different entities in different countries that are usually two-sided. And I think what South Africa did in 1994 was such a noble type of pursuit to try and show what has never been done in the world, and still today is something that many places are trying to recreate. And I think we had a brightest then. I think we we had something that we were going for, and we had something that we could ideally say we were trying to strive for. And unfortunately, for many different reasons, we just haven't reached it. And we've made many concessions, and we've been understanding as a populace and as a citizenry, because of our past and because of how difficult it is to turn around a system like that. And I think that that's why the topic of this conversation today really appealed to me, because it was around minding the gap between the ideal and the reality, and we're all aware of what the reality is. But do we even know what the ideal of what South Africa should feel like in terms of real, true freedoms actually should be now? And it can't be the same thing that it was after 94, because I think so many of us have had that eroded in our minds that we don't truly even really believe, whether it's racially or economically, that it's something that we can continue to strive for in the way that it was envisioned at that time. But then we need to actually have something else that's in place, something that we can collectively try to be working towards. And I think you'll see that in history, the only countries that have ever really made it after these kind of either, I mean, be it colonial or be it, you know, World War II or whatever, it's only really the countries that have collectively found some sort of self-identity of what they're trying to pursue together that have actually really exceeded to some extent to achieving it. I mean, no country has fully realized freedom. But in South Africa, there's just such a disarray of what we're trying to do and where we're trying to be. And you can throw around terms like economic freedoms. Everyone wants that. We can throw around the terms that we have political freedoms. But ideally, what is this freedom and what should it actually mean and feel like for us? We have it now and people don't even know how to fully utilize it. I mean, you look at the youth that we have who can tell you that they've been able to go to a no-fee school, have been able to get access into universities, but they don't even know how to access NSFAS. Or they don't know how to, perhaps if they've gone through varsity and they decided to become an entrepreneur, what the next step should be. Where would they even find that in our government or in our country? How does anyone enable themselves in this country if they're not, you know, sort of in a higher class that has their services anyway, really pull themselves up by their bootstraps and utilize the freedom that we have? And on one level, I think it's because we don't have a collective sense of what we're trying to do and where we're trying to go anymore. And I think that psychologically we need to really think about how that's happened and what we're going to do about it. And I think that for that, we definitely need leaders. And I don't think that our political system right now is actually churning out leaders. We just do not have leaders that have any kind of vision of where we need to go for as this country and how they can take the most amount of people with them. And even if we didn't have that, we just don't even have people who can tell you how to use the freedom that we have now, which we have. And it's, I mean, both George and Zach and Gita have spoken about the things that we've achieved and the things that we have in our Bill of Rights and our Constitution. But too few people actually know how to utilize it, know how to make sure that it's something that can work for them. And too few of our bureaucracies know also how to measure and allocate what their job is to what people need, really. And I think that that's really what we need to be talking about when we're speaking about the ideal that we're trying to get in this freedom and the pursuit. Thanks. And the pursuit that we're trying to achieve, both post-94 and the one that we need to re-envision for ourselves lives. And I think that ultimately what happens is when you don't have something that we're all striving and collectively working towards, whether it's in an individual psychological self-awareness aspect, or just in terms of what Gita said, to not let one person go hungry when you know that there's enough money for all of us to have something, is that our political freedom becomes cheap. It becomes something that is there, but something that no longer actually means as much, because as generations go on, it's something that they always would have had, but it actually will start to mean nothing to them because there's nothing that they can access beyond being able to vote. And I think that that's really the critical point that we are in South Africa. You can vote, but at the end of the day, the political systems aren't even really allowing us to have a real say in what's happening in our country. Thanks. Mm.